save me, O God.
O Lord, come quickly to help me.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lord God, you have brought us safely to this hour of prayer. We thank you for providing all we need for body and life. Bless us who have gathered in your name. Forgive our sins, speak to our hearts, dispel our sorrows with the comfort of your word, and receive our hymns of thanks and praise through Jesus Christ, our living Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The governor,
had a custom to release one prisoner to the crowd whenever they wanted. At that time, they were holding a notorious prisoner by the name of Barabbas, who had been thrown in prison for a rebellion in the city and for murder. The crowd came up and began to ask Pilate to do what he usually did for them. So when they had all assembled, Pilate said to them, "Do you want me to release the King of the Jews to you? Whom do you want me to release to you, Barabbas or Jesus who is called Christ?" Pilate in fact knew that they had handed Jesus over to him because of envy. While he was sitting on the judgment seat, Pilate's wife sent him a message. She said, "Have nothing to do with that righteous man, because I have suffered many things today in a dream because of him." But the chief priests and the elders of the people persuaded the crowd to ask for Barabbas and to have Jesus put to death. The governor asked them, "Which of the two do you want me to release to you?" They all shouted together with one voice, "Take him away! Release Barabbas to us!" Pilate said to them, "Then what do you want me to do with the man you call the King of the Jews? What should I do with Jesus who was called Christ?" They all answered, "Crucify him!" But the governor said, "Why? What has he done wrong?" But they kept shouting even louder, "Crucify him!" Pilate addressed them again because he wanted to release Jesus, but they kept shouting, "Crucify! Crucify him!" He said to them a third time, "Why? What evil has he done? I have found no grounds for sentencing him to death, so I will scourge him and release him." But they kept pressuring him with loud shouts, demanding that he be crucified, and their voices were overwhelming. When Pilate saw that he was accomplishing nothing, and that instead it was turning into a riot, he decided that what they demanded would be done. He took water, washed his hands in front of the crowd, and said, "I am innocent of this righteous man's blood. It is your responsibility." People all answered, "His blood be on us and on our children." Because he wanted to satisfy the crowd, Pilate released Barabbas to them, and then took Jesus and had him flogged. The governor's soldiers took Jesus into the praetorium and gathered the whole cohort of the soldiers around him. They stripped him and put a scarlet robe on him. They twisted together a crown of thorns and put it on his head. They put a staff in his right hand, knelt in front of him, and mocked him by saying, "Hail, King of the Jews." They spat upon him, took the staff, hit him repeatedly on his head, and kept hitting him in the face. Pilate went outside again and said to them, "Look, I am bringing him out to you to let you know I find no basis for a charge against him." Then Jesus came out wearing the crown of thorns and the purple robe. Pilate said to the crowd, "Behold the man." When the chief priests and temple police saw him, they cried, "Crucify! Crucify!" Pilate told them, "Take him yourselves and crucify him, for I find no basis for a charge against him." The Jews answered, "We have a law, and according to that law, he must die because he claimed to be the Son of God." Pilate heard this statement, he was even more afraid. He went back inside the palace and asked Jesus, "Where are you from?" But Jesus gave him no answer. So Pilate said, "Are you not talking to me? Don't you know I have the authority to release you or to crucify you?" Jesus answered, "You would have no authority over me at all if it had not been given to you above, from above. Therefore, the one who handed me over to you has the greater sin." From then on, Pilate tried to release Jesus, but the Jews shouted, "If you let this man go, you're no friend of Caesar. Anyone who claims to be a king opposes Caesar." When Pilate heard these words, he brought Jesus outside. He sat down in the judge's seat at a place called the Stone Pavement, or in Aramaic, Gabbatha. It was about the sixth hour of the day, on the day of preparation for the Passover. Pilate said to the Jews, "Here is your king." They shouted, "Away with him! Away with him! Crucify him!" Pilate said to them,
shall I crucify your king?
We have no king but Caesar, the chief priests answered. So Pilate handed Jesus over to them to be crucified. After they had mocked him, the soldiers took off the robe and put his own clothes on him and led him away to crucify him, with Jesus carrying his own cross. As they were going out of the city, a certain man, Simon of Cyrene, the father of Alexander and Rufus, was passing by on his way in from the country. They placed the cross on him and made him carry it behind Jesus. A large crowd of the people were following him, including women who were mourning and wailing for him. But Jesus turned to them and said, "Daughters of Jerusalem, don't weep for me. Weep for yourselves and for your children. Yes, be sure of this. The days are coming when they will say, 'Blessed are the childless women, the wombs that never gave birth, and the breasts that never nursed.' Then they will start to say to the mountains, 'Fall on us,' and to the hills, 'Cover us.' For if they do these things to the greenwood, what will happen to the dry?" Here ends our scripture lesson. We all, like sheep, have gone astray. Every one of us has gone his own way. And the Lord has laid on him the iniquity of us all. By his wounds, we are healed. We continue with hymn 385.
Thank you.
Grace, mercy, and peace be yours from God our Father and from our Savior Jesus Christ. Amen. God's word for us to consider this evening is found in Luke chapter 7, verses 44 to 50. And I don't feel like reading it right now, so you can sit down. Years in the ministry, I can do it. Grace, mercy, and peace be yours. And in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ, dear Christian brothers, have you ever had a life-changing experience? You know, like in the movies, where a guy spends half, three-quarters of the movie being the bad guy, and all of a sudden, something happens and turns him around, and he comes to the side of the angels. I don't know what it'll be. Sometimes he almost gets killed. He sees the light, or he falls in love. And he doesn't want to be a lousy, no good bum anymore because he wants the girls to love him back. Well, that's in the movies. I'm not too sure how many of us have, but sudden things that turn us completely around to walk a different path. Maybe you had it, maybe you got one coming someday. But tonight we're going to talk about somebody who makes these things happen an awful lot. We're going to be talking about repentance. It's Lent, that's what it's about. Repent and turn to Jesus, because he's the one who can turn your life around. Now, the story we have before us, probably a familiar one to you, but familiar now, I'm going to tell it. Jesus had been invited to the home of a Pharisee. Now, we're going to start right there. And the minute you hear the word Jesus and Pharisee, you expect a good intellectual beatdown, right? Because Jesus and Pharisees got together as well as Democrats and Republicans. So a lot of people, they read this and they think, yes, Simon, you crud. I know what you were doing. You invited Jesus over and a bunch of your friends, and you were going to try to get him into trouble. You were going to try to get him to say something bad. You were going to try to trip him up in his words. But I've got a feeling that maybe, just maybe, we ought to give Simon the benefit of the doubt. Maybe he just honestly wanted to have the famous rabbi from Nazareth to his house. Have a little discussion after dinner. Who knows? Now, Jesus was never one to turn down an invitation from anybody. He still never wanted to turn down an invitation from anybody. So he came to the house. Now, you got to know a little something about the way those houses were furnished. When you came in, there would be a bunch of big stone jars. They maybe have 30, 40 gallons of water in them. The reason being, in those days, you didn't wear shoes, you wore sandals everywhere. And you're walking on the dusty roads, because you didn't pave most of them. And, not to put too fine a point to it, but it was the same road the animals used. So you'd have dust, you'd have sweat, and you'd have dried poop. Between your toes. So, which when you came in, that water was there, the host or one of his people would be there. They'd take your sandals off and wash your feet and dry them in a towel so that you could go ahead and feel comfortable. Also, on a shelf, they'd have a nice jar of perfume, cologne in your oil, they called it. And that would be to pour over your head. We're talking about the days before anybody had invented deodorant. And if you're walking around all day on hot Judean sun, you smell like you've been walking around in the hot Judean sun, and that's pretty uncomfortable for everybody else, but also for you. So the host would take that jar down, and he would pour some of that oil over you, and that beautiful scent would mask any other scent you might be bringing in, and you'd feel fresh, you'd be feeling clean, and then you'd go on in, and you would sit down. Well, actually, you wouldn't sit down. You would lie down to eat. Yeah, it was another thing they did different from us. We'd come to a table, we'd pull up a chair, and we'd chow down. But they had no tables, probably about this, And probably about the height of the seats of the pews you're on. And then you would have a couch. Nice long couch, well, long, they weren't very tall, but long enough you could lay down on the couch, and then you'd sort of lean up on the table like this, and you'd bring your food like that. They didn't use forks and knives because you ought to wash their hands, drinks, whatever. Well, Simon, of course, sat at the head of the table. He was the owner of the house, and he had a whole bunch of his other friends, other Pharisees, no doubt, around. And then Jesus, well, he took a couch too. And the food came out. People were eating and talking and chattering at the table. You know how that goes. You've been at a dinner. And someone snuck in that wasn't supposed to be there. She kind of made sure nobody watched and saw her, because she knew she would not be welcome. She kind of edged her way along the walls. And once she got behind the couches, she made her way over to where Jesus was. She knew she was not welcome there. Because she was, well, St. Luke in his gospel says she was a woman who had led a sinful life, which is a very nice way to say she was a hooker. She was a prostitute. She sold herself, her body to men for their pleasure and their entertainment. And they'd leave her in the morning, and she'd have a few silver coins and go out, buy the food she needed, pay her rent, and all the rest. We used to call them scarlet ladies, didn't we? And as usual, there's some ladies wearing red. Sorry. This lady stood behind Jesus and started crying. Not just a little. No, the tears were running down her face. And falling on his feet. And she was shocked. She couldn't believe she had done it. She loosened her hair, which had been tied behind her, and knelt down and used it to dry Jesus' feet off. Then she reached into a pouch she was carrying and brought out this beautiful little pure white alabaster jar and opened it up. My best scent in the world. Not sure what they would have called it in those days. See, for me, I always liked it when my wife wore sand and sable. Sand, that would work with you, deal with it. Whatever it was, she poured it over his feet. Well, by now everybody was watching her. And they smelled that beautiful perfume, and they looked back, and there was that shameful woman of sin. How did she get in here? Scandalous! Horrible. She doesn't belong in a righteous man's house. And the Nazarene wasn't saying a thing while she touching him and ordering things on him. Ugh. And Simon, lying in his spot, he looks back there and he thinks to himself, he doesn't say it out loud, he thinks, guy's a fake. This man was really a prophet. He'd know what kind of a woman it is. It's touching him. And then St. Luke, this is great news, isn't it? Jesus answered him. Answered him? What are you talking about? I didn't even say anything out loud, but Jesus answered him. He said, Simon, I want to get your opinion about something. Can I tell you a little story? Simon said, sure, Rabbi, go ahead. Jesus said, all right. There were two men. Owed money to the same money lender. One guy owed him $500, and the other one $500,000. Neither one could pay. They both came in to where the money lender did his business, and they said, "We're sorry, we can't pay." The money lender said, "You know what? I know how that gets. Forgive your debts. You don't owe me $500. You don't owe me $500,000 anymore. Go your way. Go in peace." And they did. Now, Simon, said Jesus, tell me, which of the two do you suppose loved that money lender more? Well, said Simon,
suppose it would have to be the one who was for giving more money. Jesus said, you're right. And he pointed at the woman. He said, you see this woman? When I came to your house, I walked right past those stone jars. Get in and wash my feet. She's washed them with her tears and dried them with her hair. You didn't get down that that ointment. You pour it over my head in greeting, but she's anointed my feet with perfume. You didn't give me the kiss of peace. It was all that shit, yeah. You didn't give me the kiss of peace. But since I laid down here, that woman hasn't stopped kissing my feet. Let me tell you something, Simon. Her many, many sins are forgiven. She's proved it because she loves me so much. But Simon, people who haven't been forgiven much, they're not going to have much love, are they? And then leaving Simon and all his Pharisee friends to chew that one over. I like to think Jesus got up. Went back to the foot of the couch where the lady was. She was probably trembling a little, but he said, daughter, don't worry. Your sins are forgiven. Well, this started the old table conversation going on. What are you talking about, Andrew? Only God can forgive sins. He can forgive sins. And I'm guessing she was kind of looking around, being a little scared, but Jesus said, don't you worry. You be at peace. Your faith has saved you. And off she went. And Jesus, I suppose, laid down on his couch and he finished dinner. And how the rest of that whole night went, I don't know. But I didn't know that was the happiest lady in the whole town. Sins are forgiven. I wonder what it was that turned her around. Why was it that she suddenly wanted to seek forgiveness and get out of the business? Hard to say. The Bible doesn't tell us, so I guess we can speculate. But I guess these weren't the first tears she ever shed. I mean, think about it. The most intimate union that there can be between a man and a woman. That thing that she probably dreamed about when she was 10, 12 years old and starting to notice that instead of going, yuck, at the boy, she'd go, someday I'm going to marry him. We're going to have children. But that didn't happen, did it? No, the man came in and used her like a toy and then left. She was never going to have a baby to dangle on her knees. And prostitutes didn't get that. But that was life. She could cry herself to sleep over it every morning when the clients left. But nothing was going to change it. Then she got wind of a man. Another one of those traveling rabbis who likes to go, but she knew the type. Hail sent her and said, did you know your town had prostitutes in them? They are damned of God. But this one was different. He didn't go walking and knocking on the good people's doors and saying, may I tell you about the word of God? He came down to their old red light district. And he gathered all the prostitutes around. And the tax collectors, who didn't have any other friends in town either. And he'd say, come here, come here. I want to tell you a little something about the kingdom of God. And he'd tell them they were welcome there. That he had come to pave the way for them. That though your sins be as scarlet, and sure fit the prostitute's robes, though your sins be as scarlet, they should be white as snow. Though they were like crimson, it'll be like wool. Come, let us reason together, says the Lord. I'll forgive your sins and remember them no more. He's saying this to the people that all the good people in town said. Somehow she got wind of him. She heard of him. Maybe came to see one of his servants. And that was a life-changing thing. I'm forgiven. I got more sins than I've kept count of. And he's forgiving me. And that's why she went out, bought that expensive perfume, snuck into the place where she knew he was, wept at his feet, covered them with kisses, dried them with her hair, and covered them with perfume. Because those who had been forgiven much, they loved much. But those like Simon who didn't figure they had all that much to be forgiven, and they didn't feel they had all that much to thank God or anybody for. There is a danger to every Christian who comes to church. The danger I've had, I always tell people never listen when the pastor tells you you have to come to church. They pay him to come. But I'd come even if they were to pay me. In fact, some days, let's not talk about my payroll problems now. That makes me feel like a good person. A lot of people spend a Sunday morning fishing or golfing or sleeping off whatever they did Saturday night, but I'm in church. I'm in my pew. And we can get a bit like little Simon here, thinking that I'm a Christian. I'm guessing most of us here are Christians just about all our lives, and not all our lives. Except for the first week or two when Mom and Dad were setting up the baptism. And it's so easy for us to think, yeah, I'm a Christian. I'm a pretty good person. Well, I don't really need to inform you because the Bible's told you already. All I have to do is remind you. We're not that good. No, we're not all that great as all that you did. That came a little theory I've got about Christian sins. The Bible often talks about the sins of the world as if it's this big, huge, mixed drink. So they used to, their wine, they would add in spice to the old wine. And it said, God is getting so mad, and all the time people are coming and spicing with more sins of more guilt. And he's just so angry about that. And then here I come, I'm a good Christian. I believe in God. I know that I've seen grieve my heart. Both versions. And then some dumb, stupid, seems like a little sin to me, right? I can't use my speeding sin today because I kind of sort of bent the speed limit. Oh, why not? It says 55, but I feel 65 is what I'm going to do. That's not much. Big deal. Everybody jokes about that, right? But I just blew the fourth commandment to the side of the road. Those in authority said 55. I said 65. It's just a little thing. And then God sees me a Christian with this little thing. And I put it into the cup, you know, the little cherry on top of the Sunday board. I couldn't be bothered. For the sake of God who loved me, the Spirit of the world who loved me, Jesus who died for me, I couldn't be bothered to observe the speed limit. Whose sins do you suppose hurt God more? The sins of a bunch of pagans who are just going to do it because they do? Or the sins of a guy who's just bleeding lazy to actually try to keep all those commandments? I don't think any of us can lie there on our couch at dinner, of course in our chairs, and feel like old Simon the Pharisee. I'm a pretty good guy. Yeah, me and God, it's all fine. No, it's not. No, it's not. Yes, it is. Yes, it is. Because though your sins were scarlet, it would be white as snow. Though your sins were like crimson, wash them up, you'll be white as wool. There is no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus. God loved the world, your brother. God loved the world so much that he sent his only begotten Son that whoever believes in him will not perish but have eternal life. My God, we've been forgiven of all kinds of sins. Especially those ones that we think are just little annoyances and the ones that God come up to me, Father, think, what's it all about? But he never remembers of it. Because his son died on a cross to wipe him out. There, you see, your life-changing experience took place 2,000 years before we were born. When God's Son gave up his life on the cross to cover over all of our sins. I'm not going to lie on a couch like Simon and think, I'm worthy. I want to be like that lady. Lord, I have sinned so much, I don't even think I should be in the same room with you. But we said, come to me, all you who are weary and burdened, and I'll give you rest. Said that right there. And whoever comes to me, you said, I'll never shut out the door. There's your life-changing experience. I'm guessing that was the last time the lady in red wore a scarf. She found some other way to make ends meet, some other way to live, some way that would be pleasing to God and pleasing to the men who told her in front of a whole bunch of angry Pharisees, your faith has saved you. As he says to us as well, your faith has saved you. Go your way. And live your life in such a way that he can feel your tears at his feet and the soft caress of your hair as you dry them. And that perfume, all the things you want to do now to make him so happy that you're standing there at his feet. Life-changing experiences. Well, that's what it is. Nice little story for Lenten time, isn't it? I hope we don't be like that, baby. And the peace of God that passes all understanding will keep your hearts and your minds through Christ Jesus. Amen. Thank you.
Jesus, first things first, thank you for being so kind to that poor woman. Oh, it must have lifted her heart up to the stratosphere to have you yourself tell her that her sins were forgiven, and to have you yourself showing how much you appreciated the love that she has shown to you after so much love you've shown to her. We want to be like her. There's too many Simon the Pharisees in the world, and there's something within us that would like to be the same and boast about what good people we are, but your words got us pegged. We know that in us, in our flesh, there's no good thing. The good that we don't want to, that we want to do, we don't do. And the evil that we don't want to do, that's what we find ourselves doing, just as St. Paul. But he was the same man who said, this is a trustworthy saying to be taken in fullest earnest. Christ Jesus came into this world to save sinners of whom I'm chief. Lord, each of us has to admit that we are sinners. The worst ones we know, because we know our sins more than anybody else. But that's not what it says in your book. On your book it says we have been redeemed by Christ the crucified. So we pray, give us your Holy Spirit. Let us live our lives the way you want them to live, the way that lady did after her life-changing experience. Lord, make us such Christians as do not boast about our Christianity, but boast only in our Lord Jesus Christ, and because of him seek to do what is good for others in this world. We pray this in your name and join in the prayer that you taught us. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. We continue with hymn 125. your servants that peace which the world cannot give, that our hearts may be set to obey your commandments. Defend us also from the fear of our enemies, that we may live in peace and quietness, through the merits of Jesus Christ, our Savior, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever.
Amen.
The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ, the love of God, and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you, now and forever.
Amen.
Which, you know, it's in Bethany and Fort Atkinson is Monday, but all the way out here in Ellenville.